Welcome back to the Zeff Report. The war of the angels has begun upon the earth. People are caught flat-footed, not ready for it. But I assure you, there are some who have been waiting all their lives to play their part in the tapestry of God. One such brother goes by the name Kunita. You may have known him from his website called Kunita's Ramble, which is kunita.podomatic.com. And if you don't know him, I suggest you go there and get to know him in his talks and his great verse, because he's written a verse about what's going on right now. And I have him here, 4:05 a.m., we have monk's hours, folks. And we're going to do our duty, okay? We're going to do it for the Lord just like a soldier. In fact, that's what it is. Zeff Daniel here. This is the Zeff Report, and you're at zeffdaniel.com. And at this point, I bring my guest. Kunita, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Good morning, Zeff.
Good morning. It's good to talk to you. This is a time unlike any other in human history. And so I just thought, you know, since it's the biggest story in human history, the supernatural appearing upon the earth, the thing that people have feared and with dread and also waited for with great anticipation. And the day has come, and you've done a poem, which I will insert into this, in the post-production phase of the Zeff Report, which is something I do after conducting an interview. They will hear it. You've said in this verse that the war of the angels has come to earth, and of course it's happened before, and it's now happening again. We've crossed a point here. It's not the same as it was a month ago.
No. You know, this morning, Jeff, you know, we talked yesterday, and I mentioned that the Lord had given me some scriptures when I was looking things up on 2 to 3 witnesses establish a thing. And then this morning when I got up, and you know, Esau, how it is, it just pops up on random verses when you open it up. Mm-hmm. And this morning it popped up on, "See that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil."
They're evil, all right. And
yes.
The only way you cannot be a fool is to give everything, just give your mind to God.
You give it all to him. Everything.
Yeah, it's over.
Mind,
now.
Body, soul, everything. Works, it all. Give it all. Yeah. Because nothing can you take with you. And nothing will be of any benefit in the storm that's about to come, save God.
Yes. Well, but see, this is good news to me.
Oh, it's great news. Like we said yesterday, we're excited because this is what we've been longing for. This is what we were promised. And it's, you know, the how long, O Lord, has been on our lips for how many years?
Oh, for thousands of years.
Yes.
I mean, we have a recorded history of it from when David cried out in the Psalms, "How long, O Lord, will the wicked be able to prosper upon the earth while the good are seemingly put down and have no recourse and no redress? How long will that occur?"
Yeah. Amen. We've seen it our whole lives and throughout all the histories we've read. Now the days of the Lord are about to come.
Yeah. Well, I've seen supernatural manifestations as of late, and I'm glad to see it. I know that it can be frightening to people, but from my position, I'm in a very good position to see our people around the world and to see them you know, in California and in Texas and in Ohio and in Paris and in London and in Norway and in the Middle East, in Israel and around the world and in Russia, as you have people from Russia listening to you at this time.
Yes, because I am amazed when I see the stats coming from overseas. I have people, Russia, China, India, down in the continent of Africa, in Ghana, in Nigeria, Uganda, even in Israel. I even get regular hits in the Arab world. You know, it's kind of an amazing thing to me. You know, I'm just me. If I'm just a regular old guy who drives for a living, gets up, goes to work every day, comes home and doesn't do anything extraordinary. But yet, here I am.
Well, you're about to be liberated from that routine. I think we all are being liberated from our routines. In other words,
yes.
There'll be a time where there is, you know, the job that you go to is a different job.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. The Lord's already begun to lay some groundwork for what he wants me to do in the coming years, I think.
Yeah, he kept you on ice. You know, he kept you hidden, like the rest of us. He's kept us all hidden and now activated. But we're seeing it around the world that people were called and chosen, and we all seem to be talking this similar language. And the supernatural thing I'm seeing is that in this similar language, we seem to be finding each other around the world. But in a specific way, to a specific thing, and not to be confused with, say, Christians in general, you know, say believers around the world, people that I might see on my Facebook page or get a casual email from, you know, there's been a divide from those people, from the people that are kind of what you might call either not churchianity, but you know, sort of armchair Christians, intellectual Christians.
Yes.
They talk something, but they don't understand. They're not, you know. Then I have others that and they're stealth and they're behind the scenes, as you know, working as musicians. I'm thinking of one out in California that, and they have no idea who this guy is, and is going into these places and doing his performances and whatnot, and with the intention of doing the work of the Lord in those situations, and up against the witches and so forth and so on that have dominated for the last several thousand years.
But we are infiltrators, Seth. We are the ultimate virus on their world, and they are terrified of us, especially those at the top, because they know this. We will get in and corrupt what they're trying to do, because we will bring the eyes of God into it, and we will make sure it's seen and known. And the Lord empowers us. The Lord empowers us and protects us when we're in those kind of positions, when he calls us to that.
Yeah. Well, you know, I can tell you that at this point, and I, was it you that I talked to? I think it was you who said that... you don't even worry. Is this you? I don't even worry about it anymore. I just know I have his protection. I just rely on that, and it's not even a second thought anymore.
No, it isn't. God is my shield. I'm going to be here as long as God wants me here, and it's my prayer to him that I'm not here 1 minute longer than that. But up until then, no. Whatever they do, they can do what they want. I see him on the road. I get buzzed on the road when I'm on the road all the time. I get followed. People pull up and they'll follow me for 30 miles, you know, just 20 feet behind the van. I smile at them.
There you go.
I laugh at them. I throw kisses. I don't care. They don't bother me. You know, they're fools, and they serve the ultimate fool. I mean, think about it.
Totally.
But he went against, he threw down on Almighty God. What kind of idiot does it take to do that? I don't worry about him. He's, you know, Satan and his minions, they have a level of intelligence, they have a level of technology, they have all of this, but they're the three stooges, Seth. They trip over their own feet.
Yes.
They'd be dismissed, you know, because we walk in the power of God. And if they see fear, that's when they dive in.
Yeah, they feed on that.
They do. They feed on that, just like they feed on other emotions, like they feed on bodily fluids. That's what they want.
Oh,
and
yeah,
you just don't give it to them.
Yeah, they want
can't touch it.
Maximum trauma. I mean, here's the life of a Satanist. Okay, basically this is it: aggrandizing himself with trinkets and you know, I guess you know, some guy, you know, wealth, girls, whatever, you know, vacuous, vapid relationships that mean nothing. Exchange of bodily fluids and then boasting about it. Driving around some fancy car and boasting about it, knowing that it's wearing down. Having to do rituals of evil and doing harm to other people to keep that lifestyle going, where the whole thing is damned to hell from the very beginning. You know, their God is a joke, and they are a joke, and they really, really are getting to feel that. They're feeling that in their spirit right now because they can't escape it. And everything that they've gotten in this life has been at the expense of someone else.
Yes. 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 They have two dominant emotions. They have absolute incredible fear and they have anger. And there's no relief. And it's an insidious thing. It just, as they age, it just circles in on them. Mm-hmm. And they have a horrible existence in the midst of luxury, whereas God's lambs have a joyful life in whatever situation they find themselves because they trust in him. He gives them all they need and all they desire. I have everything, Zeph. And to the person that we're talking about, he would look at me contemptuously and say, you have nothing.
I've had them say that before to me. They say, you have nothing because you have no rank in the world. You have nothing. I'm saying, but you don't know where I come from.
I have all things.
You don't know.
I have all things.
You don't know my father. You don't know that, we are a royal priesthood. You know, we're hidden in that. We don't show that. We don't boast of that, but that's what we are. And there's nothing they can do to take that away. And, there's nothing they can do to stop, things like these podcasts and broadcasts from going forward because they're going forward. And
these podcasts are sacrifices. These podcasts are part of that priesthood of Melchizedek that we are a part of, that we sacrifice ourselves daily. And these podcasts are a piece of ourselves. They're a piece of what God has made us and given us and put on our heart. And we do this. I don't make anything out of this. I don't do anything. I just do it because God has asked me to do it, and it's the love of my life to do what he wants, and this brings me joy. It brings me fulfillment. And if it brings others out of the darkness, it's even worth more than that.
Well, it does, and the thing is that it's just a nonlinear provision. You know, he provides over here, and then we do this over there, but really we're being provided for because we're doing this. Our job is this, so we're getting provided for this, even though it's coming from a nonlinear source, not a direct cause and effect according to man, but it is a direct cause and effect. You reap what you sow according to God. Anyway, so now the war of the angels in the heavens has come to the earth, and they know it. We all know it. And I would just confirm it for all of you. It has happened, and it's on. This is it from here to the end of your life, however long you have. This is what you'll be dealing with. Yes. And that's why Kunita is here, because he is going to he's confirmed this. And whether we've talked to Brother Thomas, whether we've talked to Jonathan Kleck, whether we've talked to the numerous people I've talked to here and there and everywhere, the same.
I think even Mike, when you talked to him, was leaning in the same direction.
Oh yeah. Oh, absolutely, Mike. And the Johns. You know, John from. It doesn't matter where we go in this. This is a ministry that's global. I had something to say about it. I had a thought about this ministry, about our church. We actually have the church of God upon the earth.
We do.
And the authority.
I experience that church on Saturdays every week.
Well, but,
in
but
our fellowship.
It's uncanny the amount of people. I mean, I think the enemy would be absolutely mind blown to understand the amount of people who are not yet activated, but are in preparation for activation. And there's no they're scattered throughout every population, and they're being awakened to do the job that God had for them, and they've been hidden among the masses for all this time, unbeknownst to them, because they think, well, if it has a church name on it, or if there's somebody on TV with a Bible, that's all it is. It's nothing to worry about.
No, they'll get that call. they'll get that call, just like whatever it was that woke you. I remember when you shouted in that one night in that sermon, and you shouted to me. You might not have known it was me personally, but you knew it was somebody out there, and you shouted, "Time to turn your light back on." And wow, that hit me like a ton of bricks. Mm-hmm. And I think my message that I gave yesterday, or the poem, is a kind of light turning on experience for people when they hear that. God's going to witness in their soul. They're going to remember things. We have memories, Seth. We remember those times. God's brought some of that back to me, and others have just been there for years of times that don't relate to this earth and anything that we know of. And they're not visions of the future. They're memories of the past.
Yeah.
And he's going to bring that back, and people are going to remember, Zeph, mm-hmm. we had it all.
I know.
We lived in a perfect world. There was no entropy. We didn't need light and heat from the sun. We had light and heat from the glory of Almighty God. We had it all.
Yeah.
And for whatever reason, we were beguiled and tricked and betrayed, and we threw it away.
Well,
and I remember the judgment. I remember being able to see and do things that just can't be done now. That I remember a world that we'll see again one day. Mm-hmm. It does not exist now.
You're talking my words.
Yeah.
Yeah. It doesn't matter if I talk, because you could just take over for me, and you're saying the same thing, and vice versa.
But
I'm sure.
It's inside of us, in the lambs, when he wakens us. He revives those kind of things, and it causes us to seek him and find out more. And you know, we love to investigate and seek and ask and pry loose. And that's the things that he wants us to do now. It's very important now, more important than any time in our lives, because when this happens, when the onslaught finally comes, it's going to come so fast.
Oh yeah.
And so horrible that if you're not ready in the spirit, and I don't care if you got a backpack or not, if you're ready in the spirit, you don't need a backpack.
No, no, no. He feeds us. He doesn't. We don't need food, the food of the earth. He feeds. It's a whole other thing that goes on, a whole transformation that is occurring. And my friends, you can see that transformation in yourselves with supernatural manifestations that you're already seeing. For example, you think it, there it is. The Lord said, when you pray, you don't need to look up at the clouds as the heathen do. You pray within yourself, because I, the Lord, am within you.
Yes.
And I'm going to blossom forth these powers that, you know, you as an extension of my will be manifesting in the sight of men upon the earth. And they will also have their magic tricks. And they are, the same thing's happening on the other side. There's, some of them are being activated just like that, with supernatural manifestations of their own. So it's going to be a battle royale. You know, it's going to be, I guess the precursor of that in Scripture would be Moses and Pharaoh. You know?
Yeah, I would think so. Because... there's a lot of parallels, because it was about the escape of God's people and him bringing them into a new kingdom, and that's about what's to happen. So there are a lot of parallels with the Exodus and with the whole story of Moses, and I think that's as it's supposed to be. Paul says that all of that was given to us as a witness.
Yeah, and a reminder.
Yeah.
Because those things are you know, again, these... This priesthood, if you will, the Melchizedek priesthood, the angelic ministry, if you will, it is, if nothing else, supernatural. And the beings involved in it are supernatural. And
it's totally supernatural.
Yeah, and that means you don't fear the enemy. If you were driving down, you know, the street in a tank that's just completely, you know, outfitted with everything, even if you're driving down the ghetto, you don't really worry about it. You know what I mean? You have you're in the tank, and you have that kind of thing. But it's this self-awareness that you've got that, and what you can do with that, that is the consciousness coming in, so that it is applied, and so that the visibility of God's kingdom rises just as the New Jerusalem comes down, the thing rises to the point where, and this is why people have to be prepared. Are you prepared to reveal those manifestations in the sight of men or not? Because they will get very upset with you. They'll consider that a great threat, and you got to have that confidence of the Holy Spirit of the Lord within you at that moment, or else, you know, to be able to stand and not blink.
Something you said on one of your podcasts last week, I think, or so, comes to mind, where you said, when they bring you to that final tribunal, will you stand there in front of them and praise God?
Yeah.
Something along those lines. That's what it's coming to. And we will have that courage. The lambs will have that courage. Just as Isaiah had that courage, just as all the prophets had that courage. They will have it.
But the difference
will come from nowhere. It will just be there.
But the difference today is this group is not slain, but are witnesses. The tribulation group of those awakening from this whole thing that's going on, and they see it and they get freaked out, and they bow down to the Lord at that moment. They will have, you know, the kind of test we've had throughout our lives. You know, it's been an ongoing crucifixion for many years, and they will have it. You know, they'll have to go through their tribulation. And at the same time, you know, people have been thinking, well, is it a rapture? Is that what it is? Is it some? But and it's I would say to them, it's not really a rapture in that you're not going to, because you're going to be witness. If you look at the Book of Revelation carefully, you'll see that there's somebody is witnessing it.
Yes.
You know, and they're not, and someone's witnessing the tribulation saints, say, being slain. Who's the witness?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we have a word of the two witnesses, which I believe is still a veiled mystery, you know, and I think it's something that you can understand in your heart, but not necessarily. And a lot of the Book of Revelation is only can be understood through your vessel, not through your intellect.
Yes, I would agree with that. If you try with your intellect, you'll be way off base and you won't understand anything.
Yeah, but if you look carefully, you'll notice, and this is what people miss, there is a witness, and there are, you know, we've seen the 144,000, and we've seen others, but there's a witness to everything that's happening. In fact, not just a witness, but there are angels, for example, who are bringing about the opening of the seals, who are bringing about the the pouring out of the vials of wrath, who are bringing about the end of Babylon. And there's nothing anyone can really do about it. But while they're trying to establish their new world order, it's being completely wrecked from one end of the earth to the other. That's why I've said...
As fast as they try and set it up.
that's why I've said they will never have their new Atlantis, ever. Now, hear me very carefully, all you Masons, and I know you tune in. We have a lot of the... Listen, you better switch sides, because let me explain something to you. Everything that you've been promised in your lodges in secret is going to be denied. Not only that, you will be cannon fodder because they will start killing off their own to survive themselves. And, you know, the promises they promised you, they can't keep. So they're going to have to, so instead, they're going to put a knife in your back. And so you might as well, you know, since you are, some of you, very spiritual, you think, you're going to have to give up the secret brotherhood, because all they're going to do is, you know, as the Bible says, brother against brother, running each other through with the sword. That's what you're going to have. That's your fate, not a new world order, and certainly not any new Atlantis. This is the time of the vengeance of the holy God, Yahweh.
Amen.
Elohim God, and he is going to avenge the blood that you and your buddies spilled to boost yourselves into political power, whatever else you religious power, political power, institutional power. And that is going to be dashed from one end of this earth to the other without even hesitation. And on that day, don't find yourself begging for mercy. There is no mercy when you're talking about God protecting his children and avenging what's happened to his saints, his prophets, his workers, his people for thousands of years. In fact, you could say, Kunita, this entire system is built on the blood of the lambs.
It is. It is. And it's for the average person that is in it, and in it at the bottom, it's a giant Ponzi scheme. The only ones that reap anything are at the top. The ones at the bottom are simply cogs. They're used, misused, replaced, and your faith means nothing.
Nothing.
There's no love. There's no commitment. There's no anything. You're simply a tool And your fate is to be known as a hologram. You'll be gone. You'll live as if you had never existed, because you threw away the only opportunity God has given you.
Yeah, you kind of did what maybe we did in another time. Yeah. You're doing now.
I think so. I think it's a repeat, Jeff. It's a repeat of the same thing, and I think the same thing is going to happen. And the Bible says the earth will wobble in its space, and I think it will. It will wobble under assault when the time comes and God makes his final judgment here. And I think that time is right around the corner. I've seen visions on it, of death on a scale that absolutely staggered me. For almost a week, I couldn't even talk about it. I finally began talking about it on the chat room with Trish and some of the people I know it's hard to separate the emotions when you see things like that. And it was difficult for me, things are happening.
Yeah, people treated like garbage. You know, people put in a sausage grinder without repentance, without remorse. The wine press of the wrath of God, and without hesitation, without mercy, the birds and the dead out on the fields lying around on the earth are simply there to feed the birds, and that's it.
Yes.
It's called the.
Well, God says in His Word, He calls the birds. He says, "Come to my sacrifice."
I'm only laughing because I'm laughing in a way.
Well, it's true. This is what these people have in store for them, and they just refuse to see it.
I know they.
And Zep, God shed His love abroad in our hearts, and we can't help but love these people, and it breaks our heart when they just reject everything. And we can cast them off, and emotionally we are stable because we're in the hands of God, and we don't let it affect us. But still, there is that love that we have for our fellows, and it's difficult to watch what they're doing to themselves.
Well, they're not even themselves. I mean, that's the thing. I've wept for most of my life and been traumatized by them, and I forgive, But when it comes to war, make no mistake. When it comes to the war of the angels upon the earth, when it comes down to the supernatural manifestations, the Lord demands and commands us to rejoice, all you prophets and all you saints and all the hosts of heaven and all the kingdom of heaven, because God has finally avenged you on her in Revelation 18 in the fall of Babylon. And we're talking about Babylon, obviously, Mystery Babylon, the global Babylon system. That has been, like I say, erected on the blood of God's people from the beginning of time. And he's allowed it to the point where they think they can just get away with it. And some of them thought, oh, I don't want to be alive in that time where God finally moves. And they keep banking on the idea that this won't be that time, and so they'll get away with it. What they don't realize is they're going to deal with that when they die.
Yes.
Into condemnation.
Yeah, you don't get away with anything.
No. A word I have to share with you is this. The Lord had come to me. I mean, maybe this is just for me personally as a kind of a healing thing, but He came to me and He said, your past is irrelevant and a little more than just props on a stage. It's not real. The only thing that's real is the, and I quote, the expanding present. The expanding present will envelop you and expand so that all that you have is the present. And the idea of reflective consciousness is for me, is being forbidden. For example, just give a real-world basic example. I am forbidden to ponder the past and work it through, replaying it over and over again. It's forbidden of me to try to work my problems out by going back, and it's forbidden of me to, in other words, true forgiveness is banishing the past. Because if you don't care about the past, then obviously you've forgiven it, whatever it was. And then we're going to find that whatever it was, i.e. people traumatizing us, people abusing us, and so forth, you find that, no, that never happened. It was just kind of part of a test or a movie, but it never really happened.
It's almost as if life was a hologram up to a certain point. when you were awakened, and all of the past, all of the things, were merely tools used to mold whatever it is God was in the making of in your life. And when God awakens you, you learn to, I don't really know how to phrase it, but you learn to rest in that kind of infinite now with God, that where time just kind of disappears and just doesn't matter. Things that have happened in the past, things that are going to happen in the future, just doesn't matter. Your trust is there. You walk with God. You're there. Just like the other night when my belt went out and I had a problem in the van. After I prayed and I called my son and told him what had happened, he said, "Can you make it?" And I said, "Well, me and God are coming in." I said, "I'll be there." And that was that. He said, "We're going to make it." I said, "We're going to make it." And that was that. It's just a matter of living in his experience. There is an infinite now that exists, but people just can't see it because it's only revealed by God.
Mm-hmm. It is the gift, you know, of the Lord is the true healing and forgiveness is when you no longer have to think of the past, then you've forgiven it. But when you keep going over and over it, you still haven't forgiven it, and it's still traumatizing you. The same way when you go to a movie, you see something horrible, and it can traumatize you when you think back on the scenes that you saw in the movie. But the movie isn't real. You know, it's the people that you were born to, they're not your parents. You know, that's what you have to understand. This is a process of, you know, you exist on the earth. People were chosen. You came through that. Whatever they did or didn't do is irrelevant because it has little to nothing to do with actual reality, which, again, the past is not real. And perhaps it never has been. But it's not that difficult, if you get that word, to actually start expanding the present or focusing on the present, meaning be still and stop thinking about all these things. Be excited or think about things that you're going to do in the near future. Absolutely. You know, be inspired and have an idea to go do something. But as far as reflection, you're going to find it harder and harder because as the next couple of years go by, all that you're going to end up knowing as consciousness is this expanding present now. And that is exactly what I would call angelic consciousness, because there is no reflection. If you look at the angels carefully in the way they behave in the Bible, they don't have, and this is true of the whole kingdom, by the way. I mean, whatever, even the creatures, the angels, anyone else that's involved, there is no past to ponder, and they just do. They just go here, they go there. They don't go, "Well, gee, I went here because the Lord told me to," and think back on when they were told to go there. Those of you who keep on with your testimony, that's nice. That's nice you have a testimony. That's nice that all these things happen and look what God did for you. That's great. But now it's come the time to sing a new song. A new song is being given to us.
Yes.
Testimony's
Song of the Lamb.
Yeah, the past is great, testimony is great, but you see, what's happening now is the testimony or witness of what God is doing now. And that's our testimony. And it's a collective.
Well, that's the word he wants to get out, is what is coming, what is happening right now, and prepare his people. That's what we do, Seth. That's the only reason we're here.
Amen. Well, what we have to do is we have to make sure people understand and hear this so it digests. And I'm not expecting anyone to digest it today, but see, I'm just telling you what's going to happen to you. It's happening to us all right now. And there's nothing you can do you can try fighting it if you like and keep going back over your life and keep trying to make it work out, but your life is worked out. All of your lives are worked out.
Minus detail.
Yeah, it had to be like this in order to give birth to, you know, his people upon the earth. And, you know, the memories that we have, and this becomes blasphemy in the churches, because they want you to, the idea that you might have existed before being here is scripturally sound, but they just want you to have been, you were born into sin, and they want to shape your existence and,
yes,
and have you enslaved to them and have no thought beyond that, which is a lie. Because I don't know anyone who doesn't have memories of, you know, Brother Thomas said, well, you're not really remembering the past. You're remembering the future, and that's also true. That's also true. But there really is a, because there is no real future or past. So I mean, what we're glimpsing, you could call the future or the past, and you'd be correct on both counts. So you see what I mean? So it's hard for us because it's mind-boggling to not think in terms of linear, you know, progression.
Well, it is, because we're trapped in a world of linear time, and all of our experiences are experienced in a progression, and so it's difficult for us to go outside of that. But you know, we are eternal beings. The Bible says so. You know, we can't become an eternal being in 2011. If you weren't eternal, if you weren't there, eternity is eternity. There's no such thing as half an eternity or 10% of an eternity.
or 10% of being pregnant.
Yes. I mean, you either are or you aren't. You know, that's why I said in one of my podcasts, you know, after I'd spoken, I said, you know, after all of this that I've said, it comes down to just a very simple thing. Either you walk with the Lamb or you don't. It's just that simple. It's not real complicated, you know. The Lord will take you and shake you and turn you around, but the Lord will also let you reject Him and go the other way. And that when it comes down to the end, that's the question. There aren't going to be any other questions.
No, you walk with the Lamb or you don't. If you walk the Lamb, you're not going to, you know, succumb to the witches' rituals or whatever else they do, whatever other stupid cockamamie scheme they have to get ahead.
Well, I had some lady tell me last week, we were talking, I was in a restaurant, that she's into Wicca or something. And she said, at death, I get transformed and all this. And I said, at death, you get presented before judgment. I said, death takes you from your body in front of God in the exact same situation you died in. I said, look around you. Men die as they live. Yeah. And they don't transform after death.
Our friend, you know, Jonathan, who I spoke to last week, and that a lot of people, you know, it's kind of controversial. Some people, you know, they didn't quite get his enthusiasm, and he's really loud and he's all over the place and all this. But it's all just a Lamb stuff, you know. Anyway,
that's his personality. He has an exuberance over what is given him, what God's given him, and what he's discovered. And I found him very entertaining. Tell you the truth,
me too. I enjoyed, but
because he was just the love of God showed all over him. He was just so excited. He went from here to there, and I mean, it was just. I found it exuberant and uplifting.
I need that. Yeah, it's a shot in the arm. But anyway, he read Psalm 82. And I'll just read a couple things here of Psalm 82 just to see how you feel about it. God stands in the congregation of the mighty, and he judges among the gods. How long will you judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? Selah. Defend the poor and fatherless, do justice to the afflicted and needy. Deliver the poor and needy and rid them out of the hand of the wicked. They know not, neither will they understand. They walk in the darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. And I have said, you are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High, but you shall die like men and fall like one of the princes. Arise, O God, and judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. A Psalm of Asaph. And I just find that to be... you know, again, sort of telling of this situation. You know, you've been gifted with all this, and yet you do not defend the poor. And the whole point is, you are the wicked. You people of the earth, they get their power now. They're able to tap into that power of, say, being a god. Okay, and then they believe not only in reincarnation, but intentional incarnation, where they start, you know, trying to download dead people into the living. And I mean, all kinds of wicked stuff, all kinds of dumb, idiotic things. But they say, look, the Lord wants us to take care of the meek and the poor and the fatherless, you know, the widows and orphans, and deliver the poor and the needy and rid them out of the hand of the wicked. Because, see, the wicked system, Babylon, preys upon the poor. Look at the political thing now. It's preying upon the people that are you know, in poverty, trying to get them to be useful idiots and vote with the, say, communist or socialist to overthrow these evil, you know, and the people that are running those parties are the rich and wicked satanic rich, and they're preying upon those people, and they're not.
But it's worse. It's worse than that, Jeff. They're not just preying upon them. They're farming them. You know, it's almost as if. we have encouraged this cycle of dependency. And these people are out there, and they're a part of a feeding frenzy that's being used by the political forces right now.
By the rich. And, by the fabulously wealthy.
You know, and they can't see it. It's as if they're a beef cow out there just waiting to be consumed. I mean, that's what they are.
And
they're being farmed. They're being tended.
As Brother Thomas,
they're not people.
As Brother Thomas said, you know, as soon as they're used, you know, as soon as they bow down, basically they're thrown out as cannon fodder.
Yeah.
They don't even last 2 seconds. It's not like they're going to get to be a rock star, a rocket scientist, or something like that. And, of course, all that's for nothing. If you look at the lives of all rock stars, look how they all end in total misery, in depravity, misery, and death.
Yeah.
They get 5 minutes of, you know, whatever, worship.
5 minutes of fame, yeah.
5 minutes of, which is really just being worshipped as a god, and then tossed out as, you know, crap.
Yeah.
You know, I was praying.
Most of them don't even get that far. Most of them are the mindless morons that we see as gang stalkers or followers, or, you know, that follow people that do other things that are just a part of the evil eye that tries to intimidate us by saying, I can see you.
You know? Hey, I was in the store the other day, getting some organic vegetation, and what comes on the air, and I ran this by a brother who confirmed that that was it for you, you know, and it was the song by Hall & Oates, Private Eyes. Private eyes are watching you, da 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 da. You know that old song, and you know, I just started laughing. I said, what are the odds on this? Because they're playing completely different kind of like pop music, and they're not really playing, you know, oldies but goodies. You know, they're playing kind of, you know, stuff that's out there around today. And all of a sudden that comes up and it gets my attention. I just start laughing. I just had to start laughing. Let's just say I laugh whenever there's gang stalkers. I just start laughing.
You know, and that aggravates them. That angers them because they're frustrated. They can't do anything because we know where the power is.
Oh, I'm just going to pray. They better watch out. I'm just going to pray at them, you know. And my father, he's going to, if I bind them and forever, which I have the power to do, to bind their tongue and their minds forever. And I don't even have to do anything. If they even look upon me, that happens to them. So I'm like, you know, pretty immune. I mean, you know, unless you're really stupid. And I'm, you know, just like a lot of you out there who used to be run around by all this, and now you find you're not. Okay, that, by the way, Kunita, that's one manifestation that you can all take to the bank right now. The game has changed. They're afraid of you now.
Rising of the Lambs is about to happen. The Rising of the Lambs is in process right now.
See, they've seen what happens to their friends when they go against the children of the Most High. See, this is not the time for the children of the Most High to die and be tread upon. This is, you guys missed your chance. If you wanted to do that, you should have done that back in the old days. Today, it's no longer that time. If you gang stalk, you'll be marked for death, and that's it. You will just simply, you know, it's the equivalent of going up to God and saying, I'm God, you're not. I mean, or some stupid thing like that. Or going up to, pulling on Superman's cape, as the late Jim Croce said.
Throwing down on God is what they're doing. And that's the ultimate moron.
the ultimate idiot. We laugh at you. We have to laugh. And, you know, it's not funny. You know, there are those of us who are, you know, get tortured, or you know, kidnap someone and torture them, or, you know, whatever criminal thing you do, but then that just becomes another witness against you. The eyes of God then see you doing that, and then you're marked for eternal damnation on that moment, and that's the end of it.
Yeah.
And then your own people will turn on you because, you know, you got to keep your secret. You did criminality. And then it's like, well, someone's going to tell. I can't have that. So you start killing each other to get rid of the witnesses.
Well, that society is a cannibalistic society by its very nature, Zeph. That's the only way it can survive.
What do you think is going to happen now? You know, we've got the first opening, and kind of like the opening salvo in the war. So where do you see the next couple of years going in terms of any of your thoughts?
I think, first of all, they're going to try to hold it together past the election. I think that's a given, and I think they will do that. I think they may even be signs of an upturn enough because I believe they will reelect Barack Obama. I don't think there's any question about that. But I see something ticking off in the Middle East. I've been given visions and knowledge about some things that make me kind of uncomfortable. There's been, or will be, an agreement between Iran and Turkey, almost like the Russia-Germany, Nazi-Germany non-aggression pact, and they're going to celebrate it in the same way. They're going to divide up Iraq. Iraq's going to go into chaos. The Lord told me the key was pulling the troops out. And 3 days later, Obama announced he was pulling the troops out at the end of the year. I mentioned that to Christian Chat, that's the key. That sets off a whole bunch of timing. He is letting them think that he's a friend of the Arab movement and a friend of Islam when he hates Islam. And you're going to see in the United States a beginning of a reformation of the caliphate with Turkey taking the lead. Turkey's going to become a very aggressive power. Turkey and Iran, they're going to form an alliance. They're going to eat up Iraq, and then Turkey, as a result of that alliance, Iran is going to get the Basra oil fields, and Turkey is going to get a free hand in Syria. And you're going to see Israel surrounded. There's something else in that vision that I find absolutely terrifying. The weapons of mass destruction that were in Iraq, and we all know they were there because we saw him use them. I know where they're at.
You know, the chemical weapons and the
yes,
and all what they used against the Kurds.
Yes, they went to Turkey with our assistance. We knew that through Syria into Turkey. They're going to be brought into play at some future date against Israel. Whether this is Ezekiel, I don't know. Ezekiel 38 or not, it seemed like it, but I have no confirmation of that. But in any case, something's going to happen to those weapons of mass destruction, and they're going to be spread and released across the Arab world. There's going to be a massive destruction happen to those, and it's going to release, and there's going to be death on the scale that is unimaginable. Because to bring in a one-world government, you know, they're not afraid of the church. The church has already been co-opted. They're not afraid of the Jews. Jews have been co-opted by Islam, and they're going to destroy it. They're going to betray it, stab it in the back. When this happens in the Middle East, you're going to see people turn on the Arabs all around the world, and they're going to flee. And when they do, if some of these people come to you, if you're a lamb, treat them as the lambs treated the Jews in World War II, because God has his lambs everywhere. And if these people escape what's coming, it may be that they're lambs.
The people that are being activated and have been activated now are... not just escaping it, but I mean, you know, that God is, you know, he is going to put like a bubble around you. It's hard to explain exactly what it is. It's not really the rapture. It's that concept is just too linear and too base. It's not really accurate.
It has a lot in common. You talked about this concept of invisibility.
That's what I mean.
That's what it is. Yeah. We're going to be able to go here and there, get in amongst them and come out. Some of us will get in amongst them and pay another price, but there'll be those who will go in and come out, and we will tear up this or put a cog in this works here or whatever, and we will prevent their maintaining or even attaining toward the total control that they want. And it's through this power that where God will cloak us, defend us, shield us.
What they have to deal with are the earth changes. I mean, they can't do the New World Order with that happening. They can't really do it with a third of the sea dying. They can't really do it with, constant war, because war is hard to control. They can't do it with the plagues and vials and one of these plagues, the vision I had, which is really quite terrifying and will be to them insanely terrifying. And that is where you have 100,000 people dying here and there with no cause. It will be simply the wrath of God. It will be a supernatural death. And they won't understand how 100,000 here and 100,000 there can just be long, and they'll be taking them into the laboratory trying to figure it out, trying to come up with a vaccine when there's no vaccine because there's no disease.
No.
It's God's plague.
It is.
And
it's going to be manifest.
Yeah. That's the kind of thing that I mean. And that sort of thing, and Jonathan talked about the Hoover Dam, and you know, I have no doubt that the Hoover Dam is in play. I have no doubt that it's a target. But when it will be a time where there is terror, not just that, but terror in the United States, to further intimidate the people and break the back of the people, because, look, there's constant terror. The people start begging them for a solution. Right now they're playing footsie with this, I don't even know what you'd call it, such a joke. It's embarrassing, but it's the, you know, the Occupy Wall Street, the George Soros kind of push to have this Occupy Wall Street thing. But pretty soon they're going to realize they have to start bringing the terror in, the false flag terror attacks, because, and, you know, they'll have Islamic people doing it and it'll look very legit. But the reason they're going to have to do that is because this other thing is not going to work. And I think they realize that now.
Well, if they take out the Hoover Dam, you know, what I heard him say also in there was that will be the key for the crackdown or the mm-hmm. you know, because that'll institute martial law, at least in the West, that'll, the water supplies for major areas in the West all come from there. And that will bring on the institution of martial law, at least beginning in the West and then spreading to the rest of the country, because that'll interrupt agricultural production. There'll be food shortages. You're going to see major problems when that happens, and it won't take long to manifest themselves.
A verse from Ezekiel 38. I just can't help myself. I'm going to go ahead and read it for us.
Go ahead.
So that the fishes of the sea and the fowls of the heaven and the beasts of the field and all the creeping things that creep upon the earth and all the men that are upon the face of the earth shall shake at my presence, and the mountains shall be thrown down, and the steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground. And this is a direct parallel, of course, to the opening of the sixth seal.
Yes.
Right there in Ezekiel 38. It's just... There it is.
It's all beginning to form. I mean, I don't know. I don't know how people can't see it. I mean, but I guess we see things differently. But I see these things coming. I see them unfolding right in front of me, and I'm rejoicing. I'm saying, "Come on, God! All right," and I'm ready. And yet, other people, when I begin to talk, it's like their eyes roll.
And let's back up one more thing with Scripture. The next verse that we said today, and it is, I will call for a sword against him throughout all my mountains, saith Lord God. Every man's sword shall be against his brother, and that's them, and I will plead against him with pestilence and with blood, and I will rain upon him and upon his bands and upon the many people that are with him in overflowing rain and great hailstones, fire and brimstones. Thus I will magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I'll be known in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord.
Amen. There'll be no doubt. But that won't mean they're going to recognize him. They're going to fight. They're going to fight to the end, because they can't. They can't admit what's been going on. You know, they can you see them all come out and they say, well, I can see there's God now. You know what we've been doing for all these years? We're going to tell you. I just don't see that happening.
Well, you would be scripturally accurate, because Revelation 9:21 says this, neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. Fornication meaning satanic ritual. Yeah. That means satanic rituals. So, yeah, I don't know, you know, what more we can say. But it's on, and what they don't really understand is that just these little loser people would be the ones that God manifests a lot of this through. I mean, mm-hmm. Who opens the seals? We do.
They don't. His power, in his name.
Right.
Yeah. That's why he put us here.
Well, I mean, he's in us.
To reinforce the verse you just read, Jeff, it brought to my mind in Revelation again, Revelation 22:11. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. He which is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. There is a division, and they will not change.
Yeah, they won't change. So, I mean, but the thing is like I said, you know, the people of God, it's... And this is a call to the intellectuals out there. You know, when I say that we do, what I mean is we're not passively watching like watching a movie. You see, and too many people think that that's what they're trying to discern, who the Antichrist is and what the time of the end, what's going to happen next, and going by the numbers and you know, and all that. And that's fine, but that's still a passive, that's still passive behavior. In other words, God's out here somewhere doing something and you're watching. That's not it. The activation is when you realize the presence of God is within you and through you. This happens, which is supernatural, and you don't have a lot. You don't consciously go, I'm going to put throw a big you know, thing of Yahweh on this. You don't. That's not what I mean. Or I'm going to open that seal. That's not what I mean. He does it through the meek, if you will. But the meek are then seen, and the world won't acknowledge this. The world will go, you know, this Jesus. I mean, isn't he the guy from Nazareth? And can anything good come out of Nazareth? Yeah. This is a joke. Yeah, these people, they can say whatever they want, but I mean, we have the military, we have this, we have the powerful witches, we can move stars around in the sky. I mean, what kind of ridiculous talk is that?
You know,
they're obviously
Lord created those stars in the sky.
And they don't move them, and they don't move them around. God moves things around. I know he can do that. And he allows them, he's deceiving them in the sense he's letting them think they're doing something when they're not.
Yep. And, you know, that it brings back, you know, they look at us with disgust, meekness. Meekness to them is shameful. What they don't realize is meekness is not weakness. Yeah? The meek and the Lord have tremendous power, but they are under restraint. They are under obligation on that power. It isn't that we don't have power. It's that we use that power at the discretion of the Lord because it's his power. We don't just go out there and try and cause problems just on our own will. When the Lord tells us to move, when the Lord tells us to speak, we do so. But the power we use is God's power, and we use it at the behest of God. That's why we are meek. It's not because we lack the power.
It happens through us, though, in the sense that what I mean is look, it's not like a conscious thing. It's for example, okay, you bind a whole group of gang stalkers, but you're not going, I bind, you know, you don't have to, you can do that, but I mean, it happens through you, even if you're not aware of it. That's what I'm,
mm-hmm.
you know, but as you said, there are times where we're moved to utter, as you just said, and we have to utter when he says utter.
I actually did that on a podcast, first time I'd ever done that, about this, all this child stuff. I actually, in the name of the Lord, cast the words are coming away now. Did you ever have one of those moments?
Yeah. No, what you were upset with the and moved,
yes,
in the spirit
the millstone.
By the
pen. In the name of Jesus, I put the millstone on those people's necks.
Matthew
18:6.
Because
that's what he said to do. Cast the millstone on those necks, and I did it. And I forecast everything they touch will fall to dust.
It will, and they're done. And that's another group that's done. And how many groups will be done? It would just go back to the pyramid where there's just the few at the top that finally have the remaining power, and the witches, mm-hmm, behind the scenes that are in concert, you know, the priestesses and whatnot that have the that tell the men what to do. People don't even realize that, you know, the world is like a matriarchy. It's hidden. You know, they don't realize that it's really an ancient kind of thing. But those people, those women behind the scenes, some of them might wake up, but what they have to understand is they've been played.
Yes.
Any powers that they think they have are not theirs. They were allowed to think that as a deception to them, as a condemnation of them.
They should read the end of Jezebel. They're going to have dogs licking their blood on the streets.
Yeah,
that's their end.
They fall from a high tower, and the dogs eat their flesh. And I've seen every single one of them who thinks they have power, all these satanic queens and all this, I've seen them, and their end is horrific. You know, you have a lot of people like that in Hollywood with a lot of power. Although, it's not necessarily the actors or actresses in Hollywood. It's the little people that empower them. So I remember there was a junket to Haiti where it was Clinton and others, and Hillary Clinton as well, and others kept going to Haiti all the time before the quakes, Now, this, I think maybe it's good to revisit this. So they're going to Haiti all the time, and what are they doing? They're meeting with these mambos, right? They're meeting with these witches, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because in Haiti, they don't have any money, but they have, you know, a lot of people trade the money for the power.
Yes.
So they go to a place that you'd think, oh, that's the meekest upon the earth, because that's the some of the heaviest witchcraft and voodoo on the earth is in Haiti. And
yes,
also in Africa. So they go there, you know, so they can win elections.
They go there to get power.
Yeah.
And plus, there they can make making of a blood sacrifice is probably much easier in a place like Haiti than it would be here.
Yeah. Well, they need the...
And I don't doubt that goes on.
That goes on because they need it. They need to spill innocent blood in order to affect what they want, and then they have to keep that secret. But they feed on that. And that's why I never, one of the reasons, that I had objected to the satanic people and all that is I said, I'm not going to murder somebody just so I can, be a lawyer. I'm not, so I can be at your country club.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they do to be a member of the country club. They got to do that. Oh, they may not, put the dagger in, but it's going on around them and they consent to it.
They're partaking. They're partaking of the fruits and the benefits. That makes them just as responsible for for the outrage.
Yeah. Well, they'll be slain without mercy. There is absolutely no. Thinking about Los Angeles, I feel very sorry for the people there. We're already starting to see roads collapsing into the sea with no known cause upon the coast in L.A. Actually, in San Pedro, mm-hmm. which is a satellite of L.A. And I'm not surprised when I hear about things like that. I'm saying, oh, the Lord's showing us something here. He's showing us a kind of a preview, where things will just fall and collapse with no known reason. But there is a reason. And the geologists are all there, the experts, and they don't have a clue what's causing it.
Well, that's because they don't recognize the truth for what it is. They're too busy trying to find a way around it.
Oh, they've given themselves an excuse. They've said, it's because of this, that, or the other thing. But then privately, they're saying, no, I don't really know what it is. That's why we have this whole team here. Because if they really knew, they wouldn't have to have a whole team of geologists there constantly trying to take measurements and figure it out. And, let's just apply this to the entire Southern California area. And then we have our friends there, we have our people there, and they are, mm-hmm. It's amazing how amongst them they are. They have no clue. We have our people there, and they're untouched at this point, and I don't know what the Lord will do with them, but they're there, and they will be there, remaining right through to the end in Los Angeles, City of the Fallen Angels.
Well, God's witness is always going to be there. Wherever we are, that's where we're going to be. God's witness will be everywhere. And it will intensify. The rage against it will intensify, but his witness will intensify in the next few years.
And they prophesy about things like this, but what the people don't realize is they're not there throwing curses on the land, hoping it goes into the sea. They're there saying what's happening when they see it. For example, the Hoover Dam goes, is it someone setting off explosives there or with all this talk about it, it kind of pushes that back, but, or is it something supernatural? In other words, doesn't this work in God's favor ultimately?
It does.
Yeah, I mean, the Jonathan Kleck, the Hoover, he's kind of got the Hoover Dam. That's how we met him. But, he sees that from their point of view, he sees that it's really a birth canal, the birth to their new world order, to their new world.
Mm-hmm.
And through this destruction, and he's really proven that. It's really amazing the revelations he's had on that.
Well, I think his idea of the scalar waves and staging a natural earthquake.
Yeah.
I could see that happening. Then the government would be the ultimate perpetrator or those in charge, and yet they could deny anything, and it would give them an open door to begin to initialize the control that they want.
Yeah, and they have
that, or a New Madrid earthquake. Either one of those would be an absolute open door to martial law.
And we've had, you know, what do we have, 5.7 in Oklahoma, which, and yeah. I just started laughing at that. It's like, okay, you know, come on. You know, it's, yeah, and expect me to think that's natural, you know, and the quake in Washington, D.C., I mean, it may have been natural, but I mean, if it is natural, I'll say this, that they don't understand it. If it is something they're doing, you know, and you know, I think the Washington quake was basically a warning. Quakes are oftentimes warnings, but you had a bit of a crack in the facade of the Washington Monument, which we've talked about, and I
yes,
and I just started just laughing at that. I mean, I laugh not because I think it's funny. I laugh just because of the symmetrical nature of this whole thing, the mathematical precision of it all.
Oh, it's all precise. It's all exactly. And I think God is going to bring that monument down.
That monument is the most disgusting thing in America. And it's the highest religious symbol there is. When they start screaming about separation between church and state, I'm going, not so far.
No, there's no separation. They're becoming one is what they're doing.
I got another question.
They're becoming one.
Another question for you, and this is really you really need to pick your brain on this, and anyone else who wants to chime in with an email or whatever, please do so. About the Nephilim, and of course, like I say, they have their activation going on with angelic powers, and about this new birth of a new creature, a new creation, the humanity falls away, but it's a hybrid creation.
It is a hybrid creation, Jeff. They're into genetic things, just like in the days of Noah. Jesus said that. He wasn't just talking about people going on with their normal lives and marrying and giving in marriage. Yeah. During those days, there were genetic experiments, and there were monstrosities created in an attempt to overcome the will of God and to rejoin the earth back into the cosmos, or the cosmology, the creation, I guess, that we were separated from because of sin. And they've tried to extend their lives, they've tried to create different kinds of creatures, and they're doing all of this now, just like they did then. People didn't just dream up some of the things that are written in the ancient Vedas and in the Hesiod and some of these other ancient things that talk about the histories and the creation of these animals and this genetic manipulation and all this. In those days, the technology level was higher than we can even imagine, and they went in very, very dark areas because they were wicked to the core because of the hybridization of our race. Mm-hmm. It spawned this wickedness.
Yeah,
and I don't know. Sometimes maybe I'm not making a lot of sense.
No,
I'm trying to pull a picture together, and some, you know, I'm not as good with words as other people unless I sit down and write. But when I speak up, you know, just speak it. It's just that I see these things happening, and I read the articles, and I read, and I check the news every morning, and I watch for these things, and they are happening right now, just as it happened back then. We've got a genetically polluted society. They're trying to extend their life through the use of genetic manipulation and, as you said, downloading themselves into dead bodies.
Now, they've been doing that. They've been doing that, but then now it's taken on this technological aspect, and they're in cahoots with the fallen angels, and they think they rule. And a lot of these, and then there are some hardcore that will be activated as fallen angels upon the earth that are in human that are in human form now, and being activated with this power, but then they're going to run into, you know, they're going to run into an opposing force. God always seems to have an opposing force, you know, that you know, there's the counterfeit and then the real. And they will
There's also the other human, you know, Zev, when the previous creation was on the earth, it was the perfect one before the fall, before the angelic war in heaven. Mm-hmm. We were integrated into a cosmos, and we could communicate with intelligence all across creation. And it may well be that there were people that were outside of the earth when this war happened and came to earth, and they may still exist.
Mm-hmm. I think
and
so.
They come back and they look just like us. They are not sons of Adam, but they are human.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I'm going way out in left.
No, they're coming back, and let's continue. They're coming back now at this time, also
yes.
activated for this battle.
Yes.
This is the battle of the heavens coming to the earth. That's what you're...
It's their chance. They see it as their chance for revenge. You know, they want back what they had before.
But they're not doing it the right way, obviously.
No, but they're locked in. They can't. They have no other options. You know, they have no other option. They don't have the redemption available to us.
Well,
because
we know
they're not a son of Adam.
We know that the cosmos, as we see it today, with the sun, the moon, and the stars, is going to pass away, and when it does, they will go with it. They know that.
Yes. Yes.
And
we will return to what it once was, where we are. The light and the heat and the warmth comes from the glory of Almighty God, because He will be here with us.
Yeah, you're talking about the New Jerusalem.
Amen. It's going to be just like the world that passed away then.
It's going to
be better because we have the redeemed Lord. We have our risen Savior.
So have you learned your lesson?
It will not. Have I learned my lesson?
Yeah.
I pray to God I've learned my lesson. It's been so hard.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
You know, I've had my son asked me the other day, you know, and he said, when all this comes down, Dad, because he's a believer, he's a lamb, my oldest son, and we talk about these things. He said,
praise God.
Are you scared, Dad? And I said, no, but I said, for people like us, for lambs of God, I said, suffering and dying is easy. It's living that's hard.
Yeah.
It's living that scares you. Dying is not a problem.
When I look,
going home.
Yeah, well, when I look at the situation that a lot of us have gone through, and like I say, the pain and the suffering of it for the choice, you know, the punishment for the choice of you know, being with God or being God's on the earth, and it's like one long crucifixion, like a crucifixion that never ends, almost.
Yes.
And it's like, okay, so there's always a cause and effect. I mean, it kind of goes, you know, a lot of people would say, well, that goes beyond. I mean, I've done bad things, and I'm a sinner, and you know, I've had the curse of the flesh, and I've done the things that people of the flesh do. I've hated people, and I've fornicated, and I've inebriated myself, and I've been a drunkard, and I've been this and that. You know, whatever. I've stolen things.
Well, I've done it all, Zeb, just like you.
Okay,
you know,
so I've done all those things.
We all have.
Okay, but the punishment seems to be a little bit beyond the crime. In other words, okay, I repented. It's like an ongoing thing. Is that just the curse of the flesh? Or is there some antecedent, is there something we did, and this is what I'm always kind of wondering about, is there something that we did to wind up here in this position? And like you said, and I think that, you know, this idea of like paradise lost is kind of a cool metaphor for it, because like, yeah, we had it all.
Yeah, we did do something, Jeff. We walked away from God. We turned away from God. Some of us did it willfully. Some of us maybe were deceived. Some of us just weren't engaged, perhaps. Things were so good. You know how we tend to get when things are always good? We tend to forget what got us there. We tend to forget God. It's like we say to ourselves that, yeah, we can handle things from here. Things are going pretty good. Thanks, God, for getting me started. And that's the way people are. And we turned away from God. We actually went along with this man, this creature, this Satan that threw down on God, and somehow he convinced us. Now, probably we were naive as a race. I don't know. Those, you know, the specific memories aren't there. You know, I remember that our minds were different. Mm-hmm. Somehow we could communicate in sounds, but it wasn't words. It was sonic energy of some kind, and when we manipulated it, our scientific base almost was in sonics. Our brains operated a technology within themselves.
Yeah.
it's difficult to describe.
It's frustrating.
Am I losing you entirely?
No, it's frustrating because I'm right with you. It's frustrating because
the word that comes to me is how many, you know, we have what we call now this, our digital is just basically two numbers, 0 and 1. Mm-hmm. How many numbers are in an octave, Zeph? I don't know that.
Well, you have eight major notes, and in a full octave, including the minor notes and everything, you have 12, it's in 12s.
Okay, could you imagine
12 steps, 12
on a tech,
You have 12 steps to the next octave.
Okay. Could you imagine the advance that we had when our minds operated on an octave scale instead of a two-number digital scale? That octave squared, whatever it is?
Yeah, so it's multidimensional is what you're talking about.
Yes,
you remember.
It would have been multidimensional. It would have been instantaneous.
And multilocational.
Multilocational. We could communicate in ways that we can't even imagine now across vast distances.
But an octave, technically, oct means eight. It's eight.
Okay.
Eight major steps.
Okay.
But if you include, like say you have a keyboard, you have 12 steps if you include your black keys as well.
Mm-hmm.
Just for
okay.
people out there that don't know much about music or anything, you know, you have 12 steps, but you have eight major notes, you know.
So even if you use the eight, if you just went from 0-1 to 0-8, mm-hmm. the increase.
One through eight.
Is more than geometric, more than exponential. It's like squaring it over and over again.
But here are the things.
It's hard for me to get a handle on.
The number eight is a completion. The number 12 is like the measurement of the New Jerusalem. 1,200 furlongs times 1,200 furlongs. The result of 12 times 12 is 144.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I've often thought that part of this that we lost was taken away at Babel when he confused the tongues. That instead of being allowed to communicate in this way that we had previously and in before the creation had fallen, now we were confined to simply our mouth.
Yeah. Well, you know, it is, we have death and pain. We have mm-hmm. emotional pain and trauma. We have hurt feelings everywhere and people crying everywhere, you know, tears that just won't dry. And, you know, all of that was, in a sense, the people that had paid that price and have been those lambs, you know, have been in sorrow for many, many years.
Yes.
And there's been joy, too, but, I mean, it's mainly kind of a countenance of sorrow. As Jesus was a man of sorrow upon the earth, he's not certainly not a man of sorrow, but he on the earth, of course, yes. Picking up a cross is not something where you go, oh, good, I got a cross, and I get to get whipped, and I get a crown of thorns. Fantastic.
Yeah, even the Lord asked, you know, if there be any other way. I mean, even the Lord, when he looked
yeah,
at that.
Yeah. But Jesus, now, let's get into this. This is like my final, I think, thing on this is, Jesus, you know, we have God is a spirit, and no man has seen God at any time, but people, you know, supernatural beings can be, you know, angels and so forth can be around the throne, and
mm-hmm.
there's the throne of God. But then there's Jesus, the high priest, who is God, but he is like the manifestation of our form, you know, two legs, two arms, a head, you know what I mean? There's this form mm-hmm. that we kind of follow. That's Jesus. Because God, I think, is incomprehensible, but Jesus is our leader. He's that like us, or we're like him, or we'll be like him.
Yes,
and then
he's the first of the new race.
And then God, and so it's a birth. And so God, though, is always going to remain to be that spirit that behind everything, in everything.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus is going to be that head high priest that we follow. So the differentiation between the two, the form, Jesus, and then the kind of amorphous form, God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the spirit. Yeah. Yeah, I understand right where you're going, and it's difficult to explain. It is difficult to put into words sometimes.
But that's why we need Jesus. See, we can't follow God just directly because it's this. We need Jesus because for us, he's the first fruits of many, meaning he's the, like you say, the new race, this birth into Christ. We retain a kind of bodily, but we have a sort of structure. It's not mm-hmm. like we all just see the problem with New Age thinking and with thinking about God and just generalities is what are we all just going to become amorphous power? You know, we're all going to become the rocks and the trees and the stone, you know, the air and the, you know. Because God's in all those places. But no, the focus is on Christ, on Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And that we'll be like him. In other words, we're not going to be that form. We're going to be this form like him.
Yes.
Who is not just an amorphous power out there.
No, we will have a body. We will have a body. We will have a mind. We will know who we are. We will be individuals. The Bible clearly states that. He's going to give us an individual name that none knows but him. You know, we are individuals now. We're individuals that he's created, he's chosen. There's nothing in us that God didn't want us to have, that he didn't choose, that he didn't put there.
Yeah, and that's why without Jesus, no birth. There's no birth, because you have to be born into something, and Jesus is the only way to be born into something. Otherwise, sure, you could become the rocks and the trees and all that, but then when that happens, you are basically as if you never were, as a individual person. And the collectivist Satanist New Agers, whatever, love and light people, along with their counterparts in the dark side, they keep wanting to become like the trees and the rocks or familiar spirits, and it's just like, I can't believe you're missing this. You know,
I would go beyond what you even said, Jeff. I would say without Jesus, without Yeshua, there's no life.
No life.
Period.
Absolutely.
Not just no birth. There's just no life.
No life at all.
People are walking dead. They're zombies. There's nothing left. You know, once you get past a certain level, and I've heard you say this over again, it's almost impossible to come out. It takes almost an act of God to get the kind of contrition, for instance, like your grandfather had. That just doesn't happen to most people.
Well, I saw
a certain level.
Most
that part of them inside has died.
Yeah.
It's been eaten alive.
I saw him, go through a penance that was just excruciating to watch. I mean, his son had died in World War II, and he pushed his son into it, and he anyone who doesn't sign up for the war is a coward, and then his son becomes a war hero and dies. And then he had guilt about that. And then he had guilt about what he had to do to be a top boss of Los Angeles, and to be on the board of some 30 corporations or whatever it was. I think it was 30, maybe even more. But to be a leader like that, there was a price to pay. And I found recently, and I have it, actually, Morals and Dogma, his personal copy. But yes, I saw him suffer for what he had done, and he gave away pretty much almost everything he had made. People think there's some fortune somewhere. There's no fortune. He gave it away to allay the guilt, and then finally had a deathbed confession and all that with all these priests around. And I happened to be there just outside the room in the hospital when he died. And I wish I had been able to be there. The priest pushed us out.
Yeah.
They
don't want you to see what the things that go on. They don't.
They didn't want me to hear what he said.
Yeah. They were afraid.
They didn't want a witness to get the story out of what he's confessing to. I have an idea. There's this long list of people that are dead. I know what it takes, to run a city and to run a, what I mean? And he also did a lot of good things, but I mean, the point of it is I did see that even he, but he had a tremendous amount of suffering, not more suffering than you or I have had or others I know. He didn't suffer more than us, but he came from a high place. He was brought very low. And then he was actually at the end of his life mocked, cast aside, laughed at, considered an idiot. All those kinds of things, suffering at the behest of these evil women that were around that just wanted his money, And,
The good thing is, though, the great thing is that in this case, it worked towards repentance. So many people, and I know you know them, and I know them, that they think, well, I'll deal with God later, but when I'm on my deathbed, when that happens. But and I've seen so many, and they use the parable of the laborers, the people came late to the harvest, and they got the full. But the problem is those late laborers, they came because the Lord went out to seek them.
Yeah,
there's nothing in the scripture that says we seek the Lord.
He didn't really do that.
The Lord seeks us.
Yeah, he didn't do that. He didn't confess. He held the secrets to the end, but he was in penance and suffering and gave up
It's because the Lord reached out to him and sought him and overcame all those obstacles in the way, which he does.
And he did
too. He cast them aside.
Like a good mason, he did try to balance it out through good works. But see, I saw directly that didn't work.
Yes.
He tried to balance it out. He tried to balance it out by good works, and he just suffered horribly for 30 years. I mean, horribly. Just like it almost would have been more humane for him to have died. And any amount of gifts that he gave to the poor and all that, and he really did a lot of that, did not do one thing. The only thing that worked in the end was just, and then he had, you know, false priests, corrupt priests around the deathbed, but he still got, it didn't matter if they were false. He still got his confession out. He still got his, I'm a sinner, help me. Into your hands, Jesus Christ, I commit my spirit, and I believe you, I'm sorry, and all that. He did have that. But I mean, I'm just saying that it wasn't like at the last minute he repented. He, you know, and this is true with a lot of, say, a lot of powerful men that suddenly something happens, they get a stroke, okay, something like that. Mm-hmm. And the wife can't wait to push him off the cliff and get, you know, and get the money and get a new husband or a new, or whatever, you know. And I saw that happen to him, and I just was like, oh, my goodness, this is so terrible. But you can repeat that from him. You can repeat that, you know, across the board. And most of the men were not as good as him in terms of, you know, having a semblance, you know, having some moral character. It's just that, you know, he, when he was young, I think what bothered him, and maybe this is, maybe there's somebody tuning in here that, that maybe needs some wisdom. What bothered him when he was young, when he was 18, was that he was poor.
Yeah.
And that drove him to do whatever it took to never be poor again. And that, and okay, so that's where that led.
My father has a lot of that in him. He was a child of the Depression.
Right.
But the suffering that your grandfather did, though, that just witnesses that he was a lamb. You know, no one suffers so greatly as a lamb outside the fold.
Yeah, he just couldn't.
In terror,
he couldn't forgive
always
himself.
Always looking.
Yeah, he couldn't forgive himself for his son's death. You know, but boy, was he patriotic. You know.
Yeah.
He was.
Well, you know, Jeff, we all suffer from that. The hardest person in the world to forgive is yourself.
Yeah.
That's true of all of us. Because, you know, lambs expect more of themselves than they expect out anybody else.
But the thing is that how society turned on him as a, how he was considered by the Satanists around as weak for having feelings of remorse.
Yes.
That was considered a great weakness. And I consider that his saving grace.
It was. It was his saving grace and strength. That's what it was. It's exactly what it was. They have a different definition of strength and weakness than we do.
Yeah, it's a Machiavellian thing, you know.
Totally. Totally. Machiavellian, Sun Tzu, all of those guys are right up their alley.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, we've gone through this, so I suppose let me just speak to you out there who heard this, who are tuning in from Los Angeles. That's fine. Tune in from Los Angeles. You've been doing that. Your private eyes are watching me. So I say, go ahead and watch. Watch all you like, but why don't you hear? Why don't you open your ears now?
Yes.
And understand you must repent. Just, there's no, we all have to. If we want to live as eternal beings and, you know, get back to, well, some of you never, there is no getting back to. You're kind of like here now. It's like, there's kind of a multifaceted thing going on here, but there is no life without Jesus Christ. There is no Jesus in your life without repentance, and that means changing your direction. And that might mean changing jobs,
changing your whole life.
Yeah. Well, in many cases it does, because the people at work will consider you crazy. Some of you, your families, you young people who are tuning in, it will mean that you're, maybe your parents will try to lock you up in an insane asylum.
It may.
I've seen that over and over again. I've seen that a lot, by the way. But, you know, basically, the asylum's not that big a deal. All you got to do is play the game. You know?
Yeah, give them the answers they want.
Just tell them what they want to hear, and you'll get off. You'll get out of there.
Yeah, it's kind of like going to college.
It's kind of like going to prison, but it's more in secret when they want to do bad things to you. But no, don't worry about that. Just like, don't be afraid of anything. Remember that the Lord God is the power almighty, and he protects his lambs. And now you have the benefit of being in this time. The Lord protects his lambs. He's the one that brings in the Planet X or the Nibiru, whatever. He's the one that moves the stars around. He's the one that brings the earthquakes. That you may say, look what they did with those chemtrails. He's the one that has control over all that.
Yes, he does. And if we trust and we lean on him and we walk with him, his strength is on us. His power is within us, and his shield will cover us. And we need not worry. Fear. fear is the web that Satan uses to try and get a hold of us. There's no fear in the Lord. There's no fear in love.
That's right. And ultimately, it doesn't look like love on the surface, but when you get into it, you realize that he is the true love, and what we have here is hate. We call love hate and hate love. We have it backwards. Everything.
It's a whole new world, Zeph. It's a whole different vision of what life is all about.
Yeah.
When you meet the Lord, it can't help but change you. It just can't help it.
Amen. Well, I can't keep you anymore. I know that you have a divine appointment with the truck, and
I've got to get ready to pick up my load.
You got to go. You got to do that, and then I pray that that all the if anyone follows you, that they get convicted of the Holy Spirit and slain by the Holy Spirit, so that they may change for good.
I watched one of them the other night. I was coming home. It was still daylight, which is rare these days. And he was following me, and I could watch him. He was like 30 feet behind me, and I go slower than a lot of people. So he was. It was on purpose that he was behind me, and he was like 20 to 30 miles. And then all of a sudden, as I was watching him, it's like he shook his head, like, "What am I doing?" And all of a sudden, he buzzed out and went around me. It was almost like his mind was not even occupied. You know, they were just forcing him to be there.
Yeah. It's. I love to bust them up when they're like in the workplace or in the like in a market or something like that, or in a store, or like say at a Walmart. It's always great laboratory for spiritual warfare. And they start in like a group of them start like gaslighting you, a term from gang stalking. But gang stalking is just spiritual warfare 101. It's not. There's nothing scientific about it. But anyway, the thing is, they start in. And then if you start, I promise you, you TIs out there, or you call yourselves TIs, when you are TIs, you know, we're all TIs. But if they start in on you, try this. Just bust out, even if you have to be like an actor and fake it, and laughter, make some weird noise like that. And then go run around to where they are, where they're making noises and dropping things and bumping in you, and see what happens when you start laughing uncontrollably.
They hate it when you laugh at them.
Oh, it's unbelievable. They are scattered so fast. If you don't like that kind of thing, all you got to do is start laughing, and they just, boom, gone.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you when you're checking out the counter, they also know what was happening. The person at the counter knows too. So you start laughing. You go, "Hey, how you doing, Sister Greg? Great, nice day out there. Hey, wonderful." It's my future show bright. I got to wear shades or some off-the-cuff comment like that. And then just go waltzing out of there, just free as a bird.
Yep.
And you've slain them all. And they're all like in the aisles bleeding.
They not only hate it, they envy you. They won't ever admit it, but they envy what we have. They're trying to get it in an artificial way. Yeah. But they understand to a certain extent what we have, and they envy it as well as fear it.
Well, they just
fear. That's why they hate us. Yes?
They fear being seen. So when you behave in a manner that shows that you know what's going on and you could care less, and in fact you're going to go ahead and what another thing you can say is, look, you do that again, you realize my Father's Yahweh.
Yes.
You do realize that. You do realize my Father loves me.
Yes.
Okay, so go ahead.
And he has my back.
Yeah, and he's got my back. So I mean, if you want to be that stupid to continue with that, go ahead. But I just want to warn you in advance, you know, what you're dealing with. And if you get what we used to say tagged, now it's marked. Marked is a better word. If you get marked, that's being marked for death. You're done. And furthermore, the attachment you have to these people that you love so much, they'll turn on you once you're marked because they don't want the cooties on them.
Yes.
So just...
Yes, because once you're tagged, your cover's blown.
That's it. And then they can't be friends with you anymore, so you might as well be, you know, maybe it's God saving you. And so if that's you that's been through that or was one of my persecutors or whatever and you're marked and you know you are, I know several people that are, you've got to give that thing up. I mean, or, unless you just want to drink yourself to death down in Mexico, sitting there in the condo and you know, with your school buddies. I know all those old school people listening. You know, you have places to go in Aspen and Mexico and Hawaii and, you know, but when you go there, I see you're just sitting at the bar the whole time. What good is that? The palm trees, the oceans, you're at the bar all day, you know, trying to forget what you're doing.
So they've given up, Jeff. They've given up. They don't see any way out anymore. They don't realize that when you tag them, in a sense, also, you're giving them like one last chance to repent.
It's a blessing. That's right.
It is. It's a blessing because they have that, but they don't see that. All they can see is the pain. All they can see is, I can't get what I want anymore. I failed or whatever. Yeah. Then they respond in anger. They respond in fear.
Well,
they don't know how to respond in love because there is no love.
No, they don't have love on this earth. They don't. They have quid pro quo, and it's like, what have you done for me lately? And if you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. And that's the whole system.
That's what they have. Yeah, that's it.
That's it.
That's all they have. That's a pitiful thing. Yeah. But it is all they have.
Oh, Charles, wow, this is very powerful, very, very great. Thank you so much, Kunita, Charles.
Thank you, Zeph. I appreciate it very much. I enjoyed this.
I got to get that poem now, and folks, I'm going to put that poem, I think, right on the end of this broadcast. So if you keep listening now, as it goes to the end, you'll hear the poem of the War of the Angels Coming to the Earth. What's it called, actually, the title of it?
Let me see.
No,
yeah, it has happened before.
It has happened before. Absolutely. Yes. And then that's the thing that kind of blows their minds, you know.